Jason Snell here with Joshua Michael Stern, the director of Jobs.
Yes.
Thanks for taking the time.
Thank you.
So my first question for you is, I know the movie's called Jobs, but in some ways it seems to be as much about the story of Apple. It's almost like a biography of Apple as it is a story about Steve Jobs.
It really is, but they're sort of inextricably linked together, and that's what the movie for me was really about. It was about how Jobs really identified himself through his product. And he found that sort of epiphany when he was younger. And once he had that epiphany, he spent the next 30 years trying to achieve it against all odds. And I think even later in life, he identified himself through the product. And that was what the movie was about, him and his company that were linked. And even that period when he was fired, you know, being sort of torn away from part of who he was. So when he came back after having had time to really, you know, think about what he could do to regain it, it was so important to, you know, come back and become whole again.
In the movie, you just do a montage when he leaves and goes to next and all that.
Yeah.
And sort of suffice it to say, he comes back and starts talking to the people at Apple. And there's some wonderful moments in there where he's like, I'm just talking to Apple. And everybody just looks at him like, are you kidding yourself? Of course you're going to go back to Apple. It seems, in the movie, it seems like a done deal because, you know, there's this inevitability to his life in Apple.
And there was an inevitability. And I think that when he went back to Apple, he was much more cautious. He had learned a lot. He wasn't, you know, he listened and he was there as a consultant at first, supposedly. But he realized that this was really where he belonged in his home. And he, you know, I think quietly was plotting to come back and to take it over again, which of course as a, you know, trying to find the drama in his story was something that I was, you know, was important for me.
Right, he seemed to have learned from his mistakes bringing in John Scully, right?
Well, he had, and I mean, you know, he needed Scully to sort of legitimize him because he knew that he was having problems with the board. I mean, what's the business of vision? This is a movie about the fact that if you have a vision, how can you have a board of directors whose job is to, you know, squelch, you know, risk? They're risk adverse. And how can you do that? And for him, it was a question of how does he navigate that? And he didn't figure it out till a little bit later.
And you've got J.K. Simmons in a great part. Lots of great actors in this movie,
in
smaller parts.
Yeah.
J.K. Simmons as, he's sort of a villain, but really he's more the voice of the business as usual, right? And that clashes with Steve Jobs horrendously.
And he was the voice of a lot of people at that time. A lot of the people in the industry who were really, you know, pushing back on what Jobs was doing, you know, and the way that he was doing it. I mean, he was this guy who came in barefoot and kind of smelly and kind of ragtag in the late 70s when there was an IBM culture, which was still kind of an old, you know, old boys sort of backroom club, you know, that, you know, was a very different environment that he was sort of brought into. And I think for him, it was, you know, really about how do I get through to them. You know, and then I think he brought Scully in to mediate that, and it ended up backfiring on him because Scully was really there to serve the board as well.
Right.
You know,
what were the challenges? I mean, this is an interesting movie in the sense that we've got a very well-known public figure who only has recently passed away, and you've got a very well-known lead actor playing him.
Yeah.
And I would imagine there's some challenges, and how do you get out of seeing Ashton Kutcher, who did a great job as the actor and as this other familiar person? How do you go about walking that line between it being an impression and being a fleshed-out character? What were the challenges?
Well, we worked very hard on it. He saw hundreds of hours on Steve, and he really tried to find, you know, the character within his heart. And you have to fall in love with the character to sort of justify a lot of his actions. And so, you know, he made some questionable choices in his life, and he wasn't always liked. But when you're playing that role, you have to know why, and you have to justify everything that Steve did. So Ashton worked very hard. But I think the other thing about the role for me was two things. One is I thought it was provocative, and that in of itself, I like that there'd be skepticism about it, because that is interesting. That's thinking out of the box. That's sort of, you know, and, you know, he was very charismatic, Steve, and, you know, how do you cast charisma? And, you know, Ashton has that charisma. So there was this sort of perfect storm of the fact that there was a, you know, he understood the tech world, he understood obsession, he had charisma, and he loved this guy. And worked really, really hard at bringing him to the screen.
I think people might be a little surprised. I mean, your movie poster has got kind of psychedelic colors on it. This is, we might think of Steve Jobs as we knew him in the 2000s, but this is a period piece. It's mostly in the 70s and 80s that this
prehistory
movie goes on.
It's a prehistory movie. It's everything that happened before the iMac. To me, the iMac, that Bondi blue, pod-like translucent, and then, of course, the clamshell, you know, laptop that followed it, were where most people identified the beginning of Mac.
Right.
Most people, especially 25, and, you know, under. So this was really everything that brought him to be able to bring that to the world. It was prehistory in some regards, and that was what was most dramatic for me in wanting to tell the story.
So it's really the history of the Apple before most people knew the Apple we know today. It's how did they get to that point?
How did they get to that point? It's his early 20s, his late 30s, but his whole story to me was almost Shakespearean, which is what drew me dramatically to it. I mean, he was raised by parents who were not his own, lower middle, you know, middle class people,
right,
who loved him very much,
yeah,
working class people, who he, oh, but he always thought he was better than that environment that he was in. Not better than that environment, but bigger than that environment.
Right.
He met sort of a ragtag bunch of guys.
Great stuff.
Right?
With that
Waz. Yeah. Wasn't Gag great?
Waz, Chris Espinoza, yeah, is good.
I know.
Having met him before, that was,
yeah,
fun to see him up
he
on the
He saw
screen.
The movie.
Ron Eldard is great, by
yes,
the way. Motorcycle riding, yeah, electrical engineer. Fantastic.
And Rod Holt was a character that we had the least amount of information on, the guy, but the engineer. But, you know, all those guys, we screened it for the original Mac team, with the exception of Waz. And they loved it, and they were really emotional, Espinoza and Holt and all of them, and they just, they felt like we captured the sense of him, and that's all I can do, is hope that the sum total of the movie, though it doesn't answer every question, gives you a sense of the man, a feeling of the guy, of who he was, you know, the nuances of him. Yeah.
You mentioned the Shakespearean aspect of this.
Yeah.
And I know your poster actually has this "Turn on your mind" tagline.
Yeah.
I thought it was interesting. What is Steve Jobs' story arc? It seems to me that he has these moments, he drops acid, mm-hmm, he's got these moments of revelation about the world, about products,
yeah,
about people. And then in some ways, is it a fall from grace? I mean, it seems that in some ways, when he leaves, he is at bottom, and he's not lived up to his ideals when you go from the 70s to the 80s.
Yeah, I mean, that, you know, going back to that sort of the Shakespearean theme for me, I mean, he was, you know, he gets together with a ragtag, you know, it's more Robin Hood at this point, you know, ragtag bunch of guys, and then he gets into the palace, and he's sort of like illegitimate to everybody.
Right. You
know, Arthur Rock sort of being the king, and he's sort of the prince, and he basically, they conspire to get rid of him, and they bring in the best guy, you know, Mike Markula, and he's banished basically for 10 years in the wilderness, and he comes back to take the kingdom back, but then he's learned, and
he's very different.
He's resurrected, and he understands more now. He's more thoughtful, and he realizes the business of it. He realizes he has to get rid of the board for them to be able to do all the things he wants to do, and so he basically brings that together, and he, you know, orchestrates the removal of the board that had existed and replacing it with people. So for me, that's the overarching theme of it. But it's really just about the fact that, like, when you have a religious epiphany, and if you've known somebody who has that epiphany, the moment after that epiphany, it all becomes about that thing. And for him, when he had that epiphany, it just became single-minded obsession until he could achieve that.
How do you portray technological innovation? The scenes with Waz soldering circuit boards, mm-hmm, sort of make sense, but when you get to the Mac team, and that stuff is actually, that's a really fun, funny scene where it's almost like Jobs is finally, inside the corporate world, he's able to be a rebel again, and you can see him get some of the magic back. But the Mac story, a lot of that is software and things that are just not dramatic on screen.
They're
so
not.
How do you portray that? How do you try to dramatize something that's, I think, undramatic fundamentally?
Well, I mean, it is. Well, first of all, I love the fact that people don't realize the beginning of Mac was like, it's like the Iron Age. I mean, it was soldering, it was metal and fire. I mean, you know, that's what was interesting to me. And then when he got into the Mac, you dramatize it through his passion, because it was fundamentally uninteresting. I mean, movies about computers just fail.
Right.
I mean,
people,
you know,
staring into screens, typing on a keyboard.
And this wasn't about the products as much. I mean, we did some of it, but it wasn't really about getting into the fundamental of the software and the hardware and the trial and error.
Right, or the design.
I mean, we left things out. I mean, you know, I mean, a lot of people are going to say, why didn't you have the Xerox moment? You know, of course, we had written it, you know, because he took a lot from Xerox, you know. The GUI and all of that, mm-hmm, but we realized that, you know, there's so much about him just sitting, listening, and staring at a screen that you can, you know, we assumed that people would know that and look that up, but, you know, it was really about the man and how did he achieve it? How was he able to bring this obsession into a business that succeeded, you know?
So I wanted to talk a little bit more about the period, just because as a director, it's got to be, watching the movie, I'm thinking, you know, you've got to be a at least close to the feeling of the period of the 70s and then the 80s.
Yeah.
You've got to find old technology. Mm-hmm. You've got to shoot. I know you have, you know, you've got scenes on the street with the garage where mm-hmm. you've got old cars across the street. Yeah. As a director shooting something that's not contemporary, you know, is that a, does that just crank up the difficulty level even more? How do you deal with the fact that you can't show them driving down a highway because without like a soft focus because you don't have the budget to have 800 cars from the 70s, or to get the clothing right or the technology right?
Well, the fact that we are a period piece on a very small budget was extremely challenging. You hit on the most challenging part of the movie, was getting that right. But we really learned where to put our money. For example, the 1977 computer fair. I mean, that was for me.
That whole room is 1977.
It was 1977. it was a moment in the film where, usually as a director, you're sort of objectifying the moment, you're outside of it. But that was a moment I felt completely inside. I mean, everything, the Commodore computers, like the extras, you know, Ashton looks so much like Steve in that moment, at least to, you know, it was eerie. And I felt like I was sort of in it. And so it was a challenge, but finding, you know, this was a period movie. This was a movie about a time, the end of an era. I mean, and it's also about the people who lived in that era, you know. It's like the early 70s, mid-70s are defined by free love and consciousness and all that, but there's also the people who, the ripple effect of that with the people out in the suburbs who were in their garages, who were not, you know, partaking of free love and all that. They were in there actually thinking and creating things and, you know, sort of basically triggering the new industrial revolution, which had stopped after the war, you know, and, you know, about 15, 20 years later. What was the new thing? Well, the new thing was, while everyone was partying, these guys were going to come out in the early 80s and say, this is the stuff we've been working on for a decade. And so I think that getting a sense of that world was important. Also, the challenge was that Steve spent most of his life inside of an office park. I mean, he lived he never lived further than 8 or 9 miles from where he was born, and he lived in these big windowless spaceships. And really not attractive.
Not interesting.
Yeah,
I think you got it right. The scenes where we see him going through things that look like the Apple campus, I think it's effectively beige and big, you know, windows up above office building.
I mean, I tried to make it as sexy as possible in the way I shot it and as interesting as possible. Like, there's that scene where he's with Elisa, and it's almost like the 2001.
Yeah.
But for the most part, it was really not very interesting set design.
Yeah.
80s business park. Not nice.
I love the Jobs house, though. The Jobs house, and you get that street that they're on, and the cars pull up.
And that's his real house.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah. We shot in the house that Jobs grew up in. His stepmother, it was owned by his father and his stepmother, and his father has passed away. The stepmother reached out to the production, and we shot in that. The garage in the movie is the garage that he and Waz and all of them made. We didn't change a
Amazing.
Thing.
Amazing. No
except
idea.
For one shot. We really were in there. I mean, it was challenging in that it was so small. But there was something nice about it. And that room where Markula gives him his first deal is the room.
And the relationship with the parents is wonderful, too. That's a really nice touch in the movie to see that they're so different from him, and yet they do love him, and they support him. And that was important in his life.
Yeah. Yeah, it was very important in his life. There's one scene that didn't make it into the movie when he was a bit younger, but he loved his parents, and they really let him be who he wanted to be, and they gave him free rein, even though they didn't necessarily understand him. And I think that had to be touched on. It's not hugely implicit, but that is part of the film.
Yeah. One last question.
Yeah.
Mike Markula,
yes.
Such an interesting character. Didn't go in expecting, and people don't know about the history. I know a little bit about him as the initial investor who was at Apple for a long time and left just after Jobs came back. And Dermot Mulroney, right?
Yes.
Does a great job as that character. You see him in the 70s, you see him in the 80s, and into the 90s. And what I liked about him is he's so complicated. He wants to be supportive of Steve Jobs, and yet he's also sort of a corporate representative at some points. You know, do you think that Markula is, I mean, I think that he was a really interesting character.
I think he's very interesting. I think he's more of a creation for the movie. Everything that happened. He'd probably tell you I wasn't as dramatic as that, but he was the original investor, and you know, he also was somebody who was a businessman, and you know, Steve didn't understand that. You know, he always was. He let
it was
Steve
all personal loyalty.
He let Steve be Steve, but in the end, when it came to the fact that do I save this ship or do I save Steve, he voted Steve out.
Yeah,
and he was the original guy, and when he came back, Steve did get rid of him.
Well, that's the ultimate betrayal in the movie. Yeah. In your Shakespearean arc, that's the final betrayal, right?
Yeah.
Is Mark Hill. But he's conflicted, which I think is an interesting point.
He's very
conflicted. He feels terrible about it because he believes in Jobs, but he also is this corporate... I mean, it's that conflict between the corporation and the individual that's throughout right. the life of Steve Jobs.
And I think that Dermot really brought a real grit to the guy.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you feel that feels like a real person throughout. And real regret at the end.
And real regret. And then when he leaves, Steve, you could just see it in his face. He gave his whole life to this company. And he was the person who wrote him a check. I mean, he was the original guy. And it had to happen, but hopefully it is full of everything you're saying, that you get a real sense of the regret and the love he had for Steve. But, you know.
Well, thank you very much for the time.
Thank you.
I appreciate it.
I appreciate it.
A lot of fun. Jobs. In theaters
August 16th.
Don't forget.